We're about to get started. My name is Barry Brudney. I'm a first-year MBA student at MIT Sloan and one of the organizers of this conference, and I'm extremely excited to be able to present our speaker for this next session, Carolyn Campbell McGovern, who's the Deputy Executive Director of the Ivy League. And her presentation, How Data Around Concussions, or moving the kickoff, How Data Around Concussions Led to a Rules Change in the Ivy League. So Carolyn, please take it away.
Great, thank you. And thanks everyone for being here today. I'm excited to talk about football during as we head into March Madness, and glad to see so many football fans in the audience today. So I'm going to talk about how our data gathering process and the timeline of the various concussion-related initiatives that we've had in the Ivy League over the past 7 years, particularly our epidemiology study and how that led to us looking at the kickoff return data and how that led to us initiating an experimental rule change in the Ivy League this year. And also talk a little bit about our practice data and what were the kind of initiatives we're trying to take there in order to reduce the number of concussions in Ivy League football and a few lessons that we've learned. So in 2009, the Ivy League presidents got together for their regular meeting, and at that point we had two MDs who were presidents, and they were both insistent that concussion injuries were going to be the next big thing. This was before there were any NFL lawsuits or anything like that. It was before the NFL actually formed their head spine committee that really has done such great work in reducing injuries in the NFL. So they charged us with reviewing sort of what our standards were. So initially, you know, we were pretty confident that we were doing the best things possible. We had a great series of team physicians and athletic trainers who were really taking great care of our students. One of our team physicians, Dr. Margot Patukian, is actually a world-renowned expert in concussion injury. She was at the Zurich meetings where they determined the return to play. So we really felt really confident about that, at least that part of how we were treating our students once they were concussed. But we were challenged by the presidents to find ways to reduce concussions. Every single injury to them was a brain that really needed to be protected, and so we went out to identify ways to do that. So we formed this committee that included all of our representatives from our schools, but also we brought in some outside experts. And we were trying to find out ways that we could stop concussions from happening. So in 2010, the work of the committee got underway, and we were mostly doing literature reviews because we weren't really sure what the lay of the land was out there. There were NFL studies, that some of which were available to us. There were studies available in journals that primarily focused on high school injuries. And there were some NCAA data, but none of it we thought was necessarily convincing in that we weren't sure that it really applied to our exact level of football, because it included, and without really knowing exactly what the percentage was, the highest level FBS teams as well as the lowest level Division III teams. We did find there was one study that was done by using at Brown, Dartmouth, and Virginia Tech, so that we knew that it did include our student athletes, and so we paid close attention to this. And that study used accelerometer technology to measure the number of hits that were happening in practices and games. And so in competition, the focus that we had was on the targeting hits, because those are the big impact hits, the ones that you see on SportsCenter, the ones where you really think that the player really might get injured with those big hits. So our focus on the competition side was to try and use our officials to minimize the number of big hit plays. Other than that, we weren't really sure that we could control competition, but we knew we could control practice. If every student was getting an average of 6.3 impacts in practice, obviously that was more the more contact you had. It was less the less contact you had. And so we focused on what we could control, which was practice. So the Ivy League football concussion report actually it was released in that the following summer, 2011. And these were the final results of the committee's recommendation were to permit only two full contact practices each week. And we were the first to come up with any kind of limits. The NCAA had no limits on contact at that point. And we were the first league to come up with any kind of limits to in regular season football practice. The Pac-12 has since followed, but none of the other leagues have formally limited practice. There have been other recommendations, but we're the only ones who adopted it. We also reduced the full contact spring practices by one. NCAA allows 15 spring practices, including the spring game. We've only ever allowed 12. Those are only 8 were contact practices. We reduced that to 7. And the full contact practice with pads is only allowed once per day during the preseason. Our athletic trainers and team physicians and our coaches were also insistent that we have this other layer of intervention, which is that the coaches would spend more quality time in practice to teach the students about not leading with their head. In fact, the athletic trainers who go to practice every day, and some of them who had been around for 30 years, had really seen the evolution of how the different players had, whether watching on television, because this is what the big stars did, but there was a lot more leading of the head, and we had to change that practice. In 2012, we presented that study to the presidents, and they were very happy about the fact that we had identified some ways, but no good deed goes unpunished, and they said, great, now do soccer and lacrosse. So we did, so now we had to go back and try and do this again for soccer and lacrosse, and we found even less data available in soccer and lacrosse, and even less data available that we thought was appropriate, again, to our students' level of play. There were a lot of high school studies that we found, and some European pro-level soccer, but really not the exact sweet spot. So this is our aha moment. If we want data that really reflects our students and what's really happening on our fields, we're going to need to collect it ourselves. So that was when we initiated this epidemiology study. And the presidents were excited about this, initiating this study, but they also wanted to emphasize to us that we weren't going to be waiting for perfect data to continue to make interventions. We wanted to make them now. Again, every concussion is a brain, and every student needs to be protected. So the epidemiology study started in the fall of 2013. The idea is to determine the incidence and prevalence in concussions in Ivy League sports. So we're calculating this concussion injury rate. So obviously the numerator in that rate is the number of concussions. The denominator is in injury statistics is measured in athletic exposures, which is one student at one practice or competition. So the injury rates are measured normally in number of injuries per 1,000 athletic exposures. The thing that we are most interested, though, is to describe the circumstances surrounding the concussion events. So we're collecting about 80 points of data on every concussion injury, and we're mostly interested in where on the field is this happening? What position is the student playing? What kind of play is happening? What are the ways that we can use that information to influence how the game is played, how practice is run, what kinds of things we can do differently? And also describe the outcomes and impact of the concussion events, which is really our way of trying to identify which are the most severe concussions and therefore which activities should we be paying the most attention to. So at the end of year one, we had our two sets of data. There were 78 entries in our concussion database. About half were practice, half were competition. Well, of course, there are a lot more practices than there are competitions, so the rates of practice are 0.66, but the rate in competition is 4.73. So maybe the practice rate was lower because of the interventions we had already made, but we didn't have baseline data, so that wasn't really clear. Obviously, we thought the 4.73 was too high. So while we had been focused primarily on practice interventions, we knew we had to continue to look at what was happening in concussions during games. So our first very rudimentary chart on how these concussions were happening is right here. And there really wasn't a lot that we can draw from this small sample. But one thing that we did find out is in those 40 concussions, that'll happen during a competition, zero of those involved a foul that was called. Not one had any of those, had any foul been called. So these were all plays that presumably were legal. Now, nobody's officiating is perfect, so we did go back and actually look, and our officiating coordinator agreed that really there may have been one or two that could have been called in a way, but those were not the ones that were leading to the concussion. So these are everyday, regular playing football. That's where these concussions are coming from. This was the first time we looked at the kickoff versus pass, plays from scrimmage. And again, it was unclear that we could really come up with an actual pattern. Unfortunately, that first year we hadn't captured as a specific data point what type of play it was in football. And so we had 17 unknowns, so that's why we really didn't have much to go on here. The following year, we did capture that specifically. In year one and twos together, competition, in year one was 4.73, and we thought that was bad, but look at year two, it's 7.7. So this, again, it's really, while the practice is lower, the competition number seemed to be getting higher. I should say that our target, you know, when we looked at the vast array of sports and which of the sports we were going to pay the most attention to, it was 1.0, we thought, was what a target risk that we should have for every sport, and we should do whatever we could to get every sport down to below 1.0. So if you normalize or average it together, the practice and competition, it doesn't look so bad, right? 1.6, but that competition continued to stand out. After 2 years, we also had more data to see where the competition concussions were coming from. And as you can see, the kickoff stands out as being overrepresented, disproportionate number of injuries are coming through kickoffs than our plays in the game. 22.7% of concussions, and representing only 5.8% of the games. Not only were the concussion injuries more likely in a kickoff, but also they were the most severe in the kickoff. The kickoffs and returns was on average 13.4 days to being symptom-free, with a high of 37, and so that was by far the worst number. So again, thinking of every concussion as a student athlete's brain that really needs to be protected, we started to think about what the interventions might be. After year two, we had one discussion with our coaches, and they said, well, this could be an anomaly. You know, it's only 2 years worth of data. Our presidents are not willing to wait, but our coaches were. So we gave them that time to say, okay, let's see what happens the next year. So the concussions were down overall and in kickoffs the following year, but as you can see, the rate was still 13.9% as opposed to the consistent 5.6% or 5.6 to 5.9% of plays. So if you combine the 3 years together, this is the 20.6% of our concussions came from kickoffs, with still only 5.9% of plays. So I should say that the Ivy League is not the first league ever to look at the kickoff rule, and because of the high injury rate, there's been this push and pull in the NFL and in the NCAA around safety versus excitement of the game, right? So before 1974, in both the NFL and the NCAA, the 40-yard line was the kickoff yard line, with 20 yards as for the after a touchback. In 1974, the NFL put in a whole bunch of initiatives to make the game more exciting, and one of those was to try to increase the number of kickoff returns, because that was a play that probably the early analysts in the type of people who would be at this conference talking about how to market the game would have said, well, you know, this is something the fans really love, let's have more of it. That was the trade-off, turns out, was some player safety. So in 1974, it moved to the 35-yard line. in the NFL, and a few years later, the NCAA followed. In 1993, it moved again to the 30-yard line. Likely, what happens as you make these adjustments is the players adjust, and they can kick it further, so now we're moving it back again to the 30-yard line to, again, increase the number of exciting plays. And again, the NCAA followed a few years later to move their yard line to the 30-yard line. It was in 2011, the NFL, again, once they established the head, neck, and spine committee, recommended moving the yard line up to 35, and then a few years later, the NCAA followed after there were several high-profile injuries as well that led the NCAA to that. So the NCAA is not collecting the same level of data that we are, and they're not. They are looking at injury rates generally, but they're not looking. They're not collecting it universally the way we are doing it in the Ivy League. So therefore, we felt like we were giving the NCAA some information that didn't necessarily have. In 2016, the NFL actually also moved their line to their touchback line to the 25. So after those rules changes in the NFL and the NCAA, they saw an increase in the number of touchbacks. So in 15.6% to 43.6% in the NFL, and 15.2% to 34.8%. So the Ivy League, of course, then was subject to the same rule change, and our kickers went from having 5.4% of their kicks going to the end zone to 22%. Still, nowhere near the 43.6% that the NFL had. So in the fall of 2016, our coaches recommended and the NCAA approved our use of an experimental rule that would move the kickoff line from the 35 to the 40-yard line and the touchback line from the 25 to the 20-yard line. The idea, we went back and forth with our ADs and our coaches about whether the 20-yard line touchback rule was better and whether or not that would incent, if we kept it at the 25, whether the teams would try to pooch kick and that would result in additional kickoff returns. But this was the final result of our recommendation, and the NCAA ultimately approved it. So we used this the rule during not only during conference games this year. So there are 8 schools in our league. We play 56 league games and 24 non-league games. So for the 56 league games, we used the new kickoff rule, and this is what happened. Touchbacks went from 12.4% in 2015 to 44.1%. In 2016. The average kickoff returns per team over the year went down to 26.1 chances for student athletes to be injured in these games. The average touchbacks per game also went up. I should say that the different colors there are the pre and post NCAA rule change. And the last is 2016. I'm not sure how well you can read that. So for the per game kickoff statistics in 2016, the gray is the non-Ivy games, so the games we were playing our out of conference opponents, and we were using the 35-yard touch kickoff line. We had slightly higher kickoffs, but the kickoffs to the end zone were twice as many just by moving that up that 5-yard line, same exact kickers. And the touchbacks also doubled. And there was some question as to whether the number of kickoffs between the 10 and the goal line would increase. But that did not happen. Obviously, the kickoffs that used to be in that zone were the ones that went into the end zone without going up very much. And onside kicks remained about the same. So here's the big reveal. The number of concussions during kickoffs in the 2016 season using the 35-yard line with the number of concussions, 1. not very many. So, even better, in the Ivy League games with the 40-yard lock kickoff rule in effect, zero. So, it's a sample size of one season, but we're going to declare victory on having made that change. Oh, there it is, big zero. We also were asked by the NCAA to capture all of the injuries that happened during kickoff, so we did that this year with the help of our athletic trainers and team physicians. There were two injuries, concussion injury in the first play of the first game, actually, a non-league game, and a knee injury. And there were four other relatively minor injuries that happened during Ivy League games this year, during kickoffs. I think it's interesting that it's all in all of the cases that we have here that it was all the kicking team who suffered the injuries. You picture the team being the most at stake with the kicking team running full speed and going to the ball carrier or trying to block, but apparently that's not true. Maybe football players in the audience might understand this better than I do. And that was not my sport. So year one, two, three, and four, here we have the average kickoffs, I'm happy to report that now in 2016, the kickoffs are consistent with the number of concussions. So that shows how far down it has to go. That's in our case, we actually, the number of concussions in competition was down considerably this year, and that just one concussion it meant we were at 5.3%. As I said before, our target in all of these, in every sport, is to try and get every sport below one to have as the one injury per 1,000 athletic exposures. And as you can see in the far right, we can again declare victory that football is down for this year to 0.99, which we're pretty happy about. We still are trying to pay attention to practice concussions as well. In 2016, the second initiative that our coaches suggested and all adopted was to eliminate tackling during practices, starting with the week prior to the regular season. So no tackling to the ground. They're still doing thud practices, which is, you know, the limited contact, but not tackling to the ground during practices during the year. And it was met with great fanfare that the Ivy League coaches had initiated this. The real passion behind this comes from Buddy Tevens at Dartmouth, who has for the past 5 years said no Dartmouth football player will ever tackle another Dartmouth football player in their career. So he's never tackling in practice. They're using other methods, and they have a fabulous technology to help them with that too, with robots that they're tackling. But because Dartmouth had been successful in football, that gave him a platform to say, listen, this has not hurt us. Everybody needs to adopt this model. So we did adopt that this year, and I'm not sure that the jury's still out as to whether it was successful, whether those restrictions really did change behavior. It may be that our coaches were not really doing that much tackling during this regular season in practice already, so we haven't seen very much of a difference. So as you can see, the contact with tackling, it's obviously higher, and the higher rate of concussion, and contact without tackling, the thud-like practices, is a little bit lower, but nowhere near what the non-contact practices were. Again, combined, the rate is for 2016 is pretty low, 0.64. You know, that's lower than a lot of other sports, actually, significantly lower than rugby, for example. So we're enthusiastic about continuing to keep that in play and seeing if it affects our rates going forward. So takeaways, data collection obviously was essential to understanding the problem that we have here, and we really felt like we needed to understand what was really happening on the field with our students and what was not what's happening generally across the NCAA at various levels, but we need to be able to identify the exact problem that we're trying to solve. So ideally, we would have sophisticated research and statistically significant numbers, but I said that's not what we have here. We still have too small of a sample size for that to be true, but we were charged by our presidents to look, identify trends, protect our students' brains. We're not going to wait for perfect data to make any of these moves. So we're obviously having this data was essential to us when we went to the NCAA and asked for this experimental rule to go into effect. They don't make these moves without serious consideration and real demonstration that we're not going to inadvertently make the game less safe. So the fact that we had those numbers really helped our cause. Lastly, that leads me to the solutions may not be the same for all subgroups. Our kickers were only kicking the ball into the end zone at 5.5% of the time. With the rule change, it went up, but to 22% of the time, but that was not the same as it did for the NFL. Clearly, Ivy League kickers are not NFL kickers, and there are lower levels of football where the students or players are not able to kick the ball that far either. So it may be time that we need to look at different rules for different levels of play. And I'm sure kickoff is not the only area where we can look at that to make the game safer. I'd be remiss if I didn't acknowledge the rest of my team, Dr. Margo Patukian, who's the PI for our study, and the epidemiology study assistants that are working with us. So thanks, that's all I have. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have. Yes. I think there's talk at various levels about getting rid of the kickoff completely. I think in several youth football leagues they are doing that now, which I think is a great thing. Football still needs to include the kickoff for the level of excitement. Certainly in that last play of the game, the opposing team really wants the ability to score a touchdown. And then there's the onside kick question, because that's always used as part of the strategy. So I think that's the resistance to eliminating it altogether. So adjusting and making changes that can make the game as safe as possible without changing it materially, I think would be our first goal. Yes. Yes.
Increasing the number of touchbacks does help with that, but what are your thoughts on Belichick's point?
Well, obviously, he knows his stuff, let's just say. About the kind of discussion that we had in our league and why we did not want to move it to the 25, even though there's still a good debate going on about whether that would be the right place for it. I mean, we were on the lookout as to whether or not our kickers would be trying to do that to trap the player in the corner, and we've heard some of that, but to be blunt, I think our kickers don't have that level of skill. So that's a problem that we don't have that they do have in the NFL. But I think we're gonna stick with our 20-yard line so that there's not quite that much incentive, but still enough for the returner to really have to think twice about whether to bring the ball out. Yes.
Part of the kickoff
Well, I guess if we made another change, we would be able to look at that difference, and we can probably draw some conclusions from whatever the NFL has learned this year, which I don't, you know, obviously Bill Belichick has access to data, I do not. But I think that that's a good point, that we should look to try and make that those kinds of comparisons. Yes, sir. Sorry, I'm blinded here. Right, well, as somebody else asked that question, and the answer is yes, it's been discussed, but we really, the first priority would be to just make as many adjustments as we can before we would recommend going to that extreme. I think for the youth levels, yes, that's definitely the right answer, but for the highest levels with the most competition with the most at stake, they want the ability for the fabulous return, and especially at the end of the game, and a way to manage the onside kick question, which is part of the strategy. Yes?
Two things. One, how do you actually define an athletic exposure, the AE?
Yep.
And then two, as part of the study, do you ever do any kind of consideration of how different teams or different coaches instruct their players to self-report, and whether there may be any difference, or like people not reporting their profession because they don't want to be taken out of the game, or they don't want to be sidelined and show that they're not talking?
Yeah, two great questions. So athletic exposure is not one student at one practice or competition. So we actually have people who are recording that at every practice and competition, the number of people who are at every game and participating. In fact, in competition, it's everyone who warms up. We actually did have a concussion during warm-up this year, believe it or not. And for the second part of your question, the kinds of we, as part of our original interventions, we did initiate an education program, so that we do have a lot of different ways that we're trying to educate student athletes about the dangers of concussion. I think the most compelling is, we're getting from our data, is that the students who are reporting the concussions and getting treated right away are normally back on the field within a week. Those who do not report, delay, continue to participate, are out more like a month, so on average. And so I think that's compelling to them. All athletes want to get back out on the field, but in addition to wanting to protect your brain, you should want to protect your playing time and know that we're finding that the return to play is much better the sooner you start your treatment. Yes, sir. Yes. Well, we have done studies so far on, as I mentioned, soccer and lacrosse were early. We also did men's and women's ice hockey, wrestling, and rugby. So I think we have four varsity rugby teams and women's three varsity rugby teams. And so they were part of our data collection study originally, and because we saw such a high rate of concussion in rugby, we've now collected some of our club rugby data. And we made some interventions starting last year in rugby, but that's prime target for making further changes. Wrestling, we made a few changes this year. We saw that there was a spike in concussions during the month of November, right, and as the season was getting started, and so we've changed some practice regulations around in November, so we'll be interested to see how that plays out when we see the data for this year. Yes.
With something like concussions, you can mitigate it, or you can just get rid of the risk altogether. I've heard people talk about the future of football. Here, what are your thoughts on that, especially with the applies to like youth and college sports?
Well, I think, as I said earlier about eliminating the kickoff, I think we value football. We think that it really brings a lot to our students. We think that there's some great experiences and for students to continue to compete in football, and so we want to make sure we can continue to do that, but not at the risk of traumatic brain injuries. So we're going to continue to do whatever we can to reduce that risk. that and make sure that students understand the risks that they have. Make sure that they understand that they're much safer if they report their concussions right away, changing that culture. There are some former Ivy League ice hockey players, actually, who are doing some great work now in changing the culture of ice hockey, a new definition of tough, and I think, you know, which is report your concussion. And so they're in a good position to help, at least in that sport, make sure that everyone understands the value in doing that. And I think really, that's another takeaway, another thing that I've learned over this past 7 years looking at this is that the students who get a concussion and get it treated right away recover. You know that, and this is not a factor in their lives. It's the ones who don't report their concussion, have a second concussion on top of that, have a third concussion on top of that. Every time they get a concussion, it has a greater impact on them and takes longer and longer to recover. So one concussion is not a life-changing event, and so hopefully that we can make sure that that's the limit on the number. Okay, thanks everyone.